Our story begins with the companion of Sirius, which is the brightest star in the sky. And the discovery that triggered a revolution was the measurements by the American astronomer Walter Adams, when he deduced from observations that the size of the companion of Sirius is very similar to the size of the Earth, rather than a million kilometers in radius, which is the typical size of the stars. And this in turn implied that the mean density of the companion of Sirius was about a million grams per cubic centimeter, as opposed to the mean density of the Sun, which is roughly 1 gram per cubic centimeter, which is the density of water. Now, this discovery caused a tremendous amount of uproar in the astronomical community for the following reason. By that time, it had been well established by Eddington that stars are gaseous blobs held together by self-gravity, and the inward force due to gravity is balanced by the outward force due to the pressure of gas, which is due to Boyle's law, and the pressure of radiation, which is to be calculated according to Stefan's law. And then the question arose in Eddington's mind, what will happen to the star, which has become so dense already, million grams per cubic centimeter, when its generation of energy at the center fails? Please remember, at that time, people had no clue about why the stars shine. And the only person who had an insight into this was Eddington himself, who had advanced the notion that the stars shine because of transmutation of elements, an idea which was soundly rejected by physicists and chemists for a very long time. But Eddington was worried, what will happen to the star when the supply of subatomic energy, as he called it, fails? Since there is no further energy generation, there is no heat, therefore the pressure of the gas will disappear, the pressure of radiation will disappear, and the star has no option but to collapse due to its own gravity. And then the question was whether the star will collapse to a singularity. So this was Eddington's dilemma, although the astronomical community wasn't particularly concerned with this discovery. He exclaimed, the star has no energy to cool. Now this paradox was resolved immediately by the theoretical physicist Sir Ralph Fowler in Cambridge University, who built on a great discovery by his student Dirac. Basically, what Fowler said in 1926 is that as the star collapses and its density increases, at some stage the rules of quantum mechanics will take over from classical physics. At high densities, the motion of the particle is due to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, and the energy of the particles is due to a combined effect of uncertainty principle and Pauli's exclusion principle if you are dealing with Fermi particles. Till that time, please remember, one did not have the distinction of Fermi particles, and Bose statistics existed, but Fermi statistics didn't exist. So Fowler argued that at high pressure, a new pressure will arise, a quantum pressure, and that quantum pressure will stop gravity at some stage, at some radius, and so what you will have is a quantum star. It's all very elementary notions today when viewed today, but I would like you to look back and place yourself at that time. As I said, Dirac was Fowler's student. In August 1926, Dirac came to Fowler with a paper on the discovery of the new statistics, which had been made same time independently by Fermi in Rome, and requested Fowler to communicate it to a suitable journal. Within 2 months, in November 1926, Fowler had applied these new ideas to save the companion of Sirius. It is very remarkable and not generally known that this was the very first application of the newly discovered quantum statistics. Please remember, at that time, we thought of quantum statistics and quantum mechanics was relevant in the world of atoms and molecules, But the first application of the Fermi-Dirac statistics was to a star. And then came, within a matter of months, the great derivation by Sommerfeld on the free electron theory of metals and Pauli's explanation for the paramagnetism of metals. Well, what Fowler said at that time was that in the case of Fermi particles, you have to populate the energy levels like this. You are allowed to put, if you like, two electrons in each energy level. But the point is that at absolute zero of temperature, an electron gas has a finite energy. And as you compress the gas and reduce the volume or increase the number of particles, the maximum level up to which you will populate the energy levels increases, and that energy is today called the Fermi energy. Therefore, an electron gas at absolute zero of temperature has an enormous amount of ground state energy, zero point energy, and that is pressure. And Fowler argued that it is this pressure that will oppose gravity in stars like the companion of Sirius when it decides to call it quits. So once the quantum mechanical pressure of the electron stops the collapse, the star would have found its ultimate peace. Nothing can happen to it like before. Nothing can happen to it because, as Fowler said, what is stopping gravity is zero-point motion. He likened the companion of Sirius to the electron in the ground state of a hydrogen atom, which has an enormous amount of energy, but it can't spend it because there is no energy level lower than that. So he likened the star to a gigantic molecule in its ground state. And in the ground state, nothing can happen to a system. So the idea is that such stars will be stable forever. These stars, which are bright and white, will eventually become black because they would have radiated away the fossil heat. But the important thing is they are forever. Now, it is at that stage young Chandrasekhar entered the story. He was a young student in studying BSc in Presidency College in Madras. He learned about these discoveries from Sommerfeld, who happened to be visiting Madras for a few days in 1928. And Chandrasekhar decided, let me now calculate the properties of such a quantum star, like Eddington had calculated the properties of gaseous star. In the case of gaseous star, you balance gravity with gas pressure and radiation pressure. Whereas, and how do you do that? Well, you invoke the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. You consider a unit cylinder at some radius inside the star and demand that the gravitational force acting on it due to the mass interior to that is balanced by the pressure forces which are pushing the cylinder upwards. So the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium is dP by dr is minus gm rho over r squared, where P is the total pressure, the sum of gas pressure and radiation pressure. The gas pressure is to be calculated according to Boyle's law, and the radiation pressure is, of course, Stefan's law. So what Chandrasekhar decided to do was to do an identical thing, but this time you're dealing with a quantum star in which gravitational pressure is balanced by the pressure of electrons, which arises due to the Fermi-Dirac rules. Now, the first implication of Fermi-Dirac statistics is that phase space, which was continuous in classical physics, is now discrete. It is made up of little blocks, and the size of each block is Planck's constant divided by the size of the box, whole cube, or which is h cubed divided by the volume of the box. And then you're allowed to put two electrons or protons or neutrons in each of these elementary blocks. So let us calculate what is the maximum momentum an electron gas will have at absolute zero of temperature. It clearly depends on how many electrons I give you And the rule of the game is you go on populating it till you have you found a place for all the electrons. So a sphere of radius PF, which is called the Fermi momentum, is fully occupied. And outside of that sphere, a phase space is empty. The number of occupied cells inside that is the volume of the sphere divided by the volume of the elementary block. And therefore, the number of particles inside the sphere is twice that, since I am allowed to put two particles provided their spin angular momenta are oriented in opposite direction. Therefore, the Fermi momentum of a Fermi gas is proportional to the density to the power 1/3. I want you to appreciate that in the formula on the left-hand side, mass of the particle does not enter. Therefore, this formula is valid even in relativity. Okay? This density to the power 1/3 arises basically from Heisenberg's principle, which quantizes space-space, and Pauli's principle. It has nothing whatsoever to do with Newton or relativity. So here is a summary. As I compress an electron gas, the Fermi sphere will become larger and larger, and the Fermi momentum will increase. As for the Fermi energy in Newtonian mechanics is p squared divided by 2m, and therefore the Fermi energy is proportional to 2/3 power of the density, but this time the mass of the particle does appear, and it appears in the denominator, and therefore the Fermi energy of a neutron gas or a proton gas will be 2,000 times less, even though I have the same number of protons and neutrons as electrons. This will become important to a star, as we will see presently. Therefore, in non-relativistic mechanics, the Fermi energy is proportional to 2/3 power of density. So here is a summary. The Fermi momentum is proportional to 1/3 power of density. The Fermi energy is proportional to 2/3 power of density. Now, just to recall, the pressure of a gas from the first law of thermodynamics is related to its internal energy, and the pressure of particles with finite mass is 2/3 times the internal energy per unit volume. Now, if you calculate the energy according to classical statistics, the average energy of the particles is 3/2 kT. Therefore, the total internal energy is n into 3/2 kT. Therefore, the pressure is nkT, which is, of course, Boyle's law. Okay? And this pressure vanishes at absolute zero of temperature. But now we go to a Fermi gas. We do the same thing. The internal energy is n times the average energy of the particle. The average energy of the particle is roughly the Fermi energy, or some fraction of it, 3/5 the Fermi energy. And therefore, that will give me density to the power 5/3, because there is n to the power 1 here, n to the power 2/3. Therefore, the pressure of a non-relativistic Fermi gas is proportional to density to the power 5/3. I have worked out some little estimates for you in a problem sheet that you should do this afternoon in the tutorial. I would like you to calculate these expressions. Please remember, it's all very well to write expressions like dot, 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 which I like to do in a lecture, but physics is all about getting those numbers and pi's correct. So all these things I've deliberately left vague, and this afternoon you should work these things out. Now, how did Chandrasekhar construct quantum stars? Well, he started out with the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, which remains the same because we are still in Newtonian mechanics. But for the pressure of the gas, instead of Boyle's law and Stefan's law, he assumed that the pressure of the electron gas is given by density to the power 5/3. You notice here I've written density in terms of rho, which is mass density. Previously, I had written formulas in terms of number density, because in statistical mechanics, you deal with numbers of particles, but in gravity, you want to deal with masses. So you have to multiply and divide by the masses, and therefore, please work out what this constant K1 is for the pressure, okay? Written in terms of the density. Okay, so when Chandrasekhar solved that equation, what he found is that the radius of the star was inversely proportional to the cube root of the mass. Okay? The famous Chinese saying, one picture is worth 10,000 words, so let's plot it. What is plotted on the y-axis is the radius of the star. What is plotted on the x-axis is the mass of the sequence of such stars. And this yellow line is r proportional to m to the power minus 1 by 3. Chandrasekhar also calculated that the mean density of such a star will be proportional to the square of the mass. Therefore, larger the mass, the larger the density. And the central density is 6 times the average density. This is a mathematically exact result. At that time, there were only 3 such stars known when Chandrasekhar did this theory. And so their masses were roughly the mass of the sun. So this equation of mass-radius relation, this figure tells you that if the mass of the star is one solar mass, then its radius ought to be 10,000 kilometers, which was precisely the radius of the companion of Sirius. So this simple theory, based on the ideas of Fowler, spectacularly explained the observed radii of the 3 white dwarfs that were known in 1928. So the conclusion of this paper was that stars of all mass will find their ultimate peace as quantum stars supported by the degeneracy pressure of the electrons. Today, if you point the Hubble Space Telescope towards a globular cluster, you see lots of these white dwarfs. Every star that you see in this picture is a white dwarf. Size of the Earth, density of 1,000,000 grams per cubic centimeter. I leave you to argue during the coffee break and lunch breaks and why you see these beautiful crosses in these photographs. And why you see these crosses only around the brighter ones and not around the fainter ones. Now, these white dwarfs, there is no energy generation, so they simply radiate away the fossil heat, area times sigma t to the power 4, and after billions of years, they will cool down. And as they cool down, they will crystallize. And the overwhelming majority of these white dwarfs are made of carbon, and therefore there will be crystallized forms of carbon. And at high pressure, people have argued that it will have a diamond structure. So the galaxy is full of these diamonds, each 10 to the power 33 grams. For 3 of them, how do you know all this is true? For 3 white dwarfs, very recently, people have deduced through astroseismology from vibrations of these white dwarfs, the internal structure must be crystalline, that it is a solid. And we know that these are carbon white dwarfs with an admixture of oxygen. The rest is conjecture whether the crystal, it could be Buckminster fullerene, it could be graphene, but the conjecture from the phase diagrams, if you can extrapolate it to this kind of ridiculously high densities, is that they will crystallize into the diamond structure. So you would think, diamonds are forever, right? Well, that turned out not to be the case. Now, soon after completing this theory, Chandrasekhar began to wonder about the implications of this, whether he had got everything right in his theory. He knew he had got the mathematics correctly, and most of the physics was correct, except he was bothered by one little fact. As the density of the star increases, the Fermi momentum will increase. And at some stage, the Fermi momentum will become comparable to mass times the speed of light, at which point you are no longer allowed to use Newtonian mechanics. You have to use special relativity, and therefore you cannot write the energy of the particle as p squared divided by 2m. So he realized that he had to make that modification. Let's briefly recall what will be the formula for the relativistic gas. As far as the Fermi momentum is concerned, there is no change because this formula is valid even in relativity. But that formula is not valid. The Fermi energy can no longer be written as pf squared divided by 2m. For ultra-relativistic, well, Einstein taught us that that is the relation between energy and momentum of the particle. But if you are willing to assume that the particles are all ultra-relativistic, which is what Chandrasekhar assumed at that stage, then the energy of the particle is of the order of momentum times the speed of light. Therefore, that expression for the Fermi energy will change. EF is proportional to PF. And therefore, EF will again be proportional to density to the power 1 by 3 and not density to the power 2 by 3. And that makes an essential, therefore, the Fermi energy will be proportional to density to the power 1 by 3 once again. Please note that the Fermi energy of a relativistic gas does not involve the mass for a very good reason. You say a particle is ultra-relativistic when its kinetic energy is very much larger than rest mass energy. Therefore, it shouldn't matter to you what the mass of the particle is. And that's what this formula is telling you. Now, the degeneracy pressure of an electron gas with that relation between pressure and energy can be calculated, but I'm going to skip this and leave it as an exercise for you. But basically, it is the same thing. You calculate the total energy. The total energy is the number of particles multiplied by the average energy. The number of particles is n. The average energy is roughly the Fermi energy, which is density to the power 1 by 3. So n into n to the power 1 by 3 gives you n to the power 4 by 3 at this time, and not 5 by 3 as we got before. And therefore, the pressure of a relativistic electron gas is proportional to dot, 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 n to the power 4 by 3. I would like you to work out this full expression that I have given here for the degeneracy pressure of a non-relativistic gas as well as for a relativistic gas. Because please, you must get these constants correct if you are going to be able to do the further calculations based on this. So, to summarize, the pressure of the gas, the expression for the pressure that you had used previously was n to the power 5 by 3, whereas what you should really do when you are dealing with a very dense white dwarf where the particles are relativistic is that the pressure is density to the power 4 by 3. But the rest of it is exactly the same. You integrate the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. Instead of the pressure being proportional to density to the power 5 by 3, which is good enough for low-mass white dwarfs whose density is low, you use density to the power 4 by 3. Now, it turns out that this is a polytropic equation of a particular index which can be solved exactly. And Chandrasekhar solved this problem exactly, and what he found was a very remarkable result. And that is, this star has no radius. Now, please do the following. Please learn to do some scaling arguments. dP by dr is minus gm rho by r squared. By scaling argument, I want to know how something depends on some other quantity, and I'm not asking the details of proportionality constant. So there, imagine that you're living in pre-Newtonian times. Replace dP by dr as p over r, because after all, dP by dr is p1 minus p2 divided by r1 minus r2. So you treat one point at the center, one point at the surface of the star, and convince yourself that if I put for pressure density to the power 5 by 3, I get r is proportional to 1 over m to the power 1 by 3. You won't get the constant unless you integrate the equation like Chandrasekhar did. But this you should do. It will take you about 60 seconds to do this. And if you do this for density to the power 4 by 3, you find the star has no radius. But the star has a mass. And this is one of the most beautiful results in all of physics. This mass of a completely relativistic star is defined uniquely by fundamental constants. And its value is cube of the Planck mass divided by the square of the proton mass. Or more explicitly, it is 0.197 8c by g to the power 3 halves, that is your Planck mass, square root of that, 1 divided by mass, square of the mass of the proton, multiplied by 1 over mu squared. This tells you how many electrons are there per nucleon in the nucleus. As you know, if you leave out hydrogen in the periodic table, for the rest of the periodic table, A over Z, the atomic number divided by the atomic charge, is 2 for all the elements. Therefore, mu is 2. Therefore, you get the famous result, the Chandrasekhar limiting mass is 1.4 times the mass of the sun. Please remember, that is just a way of writing it, but the real expression is a mathematically exact expression. Well, then in a couple of years, Chandrasekhar said that why should I use energy is equal to P times C? That is also an approximation. This is ultra treating the all the particles are ultra relativistic. So you use the correct expression that Einstein gave, E squared is equal to m0c to the power 4, m0 squared c to the power 4, p squared c squared. It's a hard thing to integrate. Those days there were no calculators, let alone computers. And so it took a long time to do this, but he did this. And what he found was that for in the exact calculation, for low density stars, or stars of very low mass, the relativistic theory agreed with the Newtonian theory, as it should. And for larger mass, there was a significant deviation. Around one solar mass, the mass radius relation curve took a nosedive, and the radius went to zero at 1.4 times the mass of the sun. And that is the famous Chandrasekhar limiting mass. What happens to a star more massive than this? The conclusion at that time was, please remember, at that time, the only two known elementary particles were the proton and the electron. Neutron had not been discovered. Therefore, one had no option but to conclude the stars more massive than 1.4 quantum stars, more massive than 1.4 solar mass, will have to collapse. They will collapse to a singularity. Now, this discovery revolutionized our views of the heavens. As you will see, it took us 50 years to appreciate the significance of this. It took almost 50 years. But what this discovery signaled was the gravitational collapse of massive stars. 50 years later, this led to the notion of neutron stars, supernova explosions, and black holes. And the great discovery marked the beginning of a revolution in astrophysics, that of high-energy astrophysics. So now let's move on from quantum stars in which gravity is balanced by the pressure of electrons to more exotic stars. And let us go back to the Chinese 2,000 years ago. The Chinese had noted that every now and then a new star appears in the sky. Like good guests, they disappear after a while. Sometimes they stay for weeks, sometimes for months, sometimes for 1 or 2 years, and then they fade away. And they recorded them very methodically, how their brightness increased day by day and how their brightness decreased, by holding a grain of rice in their hand, which gave you an angular measure at arm's length. And so they simply recorded. You know, what for? Nobody knew. But that's what good science is about. When you observe something, you write it down. And then much later, Tycho Brahe did that. Johannes Kepler did that. And today we know what these are. And the reason why we know what these guest stars are is because one guest star was seen in this nebula, Andromeda Nebula, something that looks like an omelet, in the year 1885. In the year 1885, one thought this Andromeda Nebula was part of our galaxy. In fact, there was nothing in the universe other than just our galaxy. Then in the year, for example, This guest star in this Andromeda galaxy, in nebula, suddenly acquired significance when Hubble discovered that this Andromeda nebula was at a distance of 3 million light years. Therefore, it couldn't possibly be inside our galaxy. So it was a galaxy in its own. So if an object, if a guest star is 3 million light years away from us, then it must have been awfully bright. Because when it was brightest, photography had not been invented at that time. Astronomical photography didn't exist at that time. For example, here is a more recent supernova in an external galaxy. At its brightness, you notice that it is as bright as the whole galaxy. And this was noticed in 1885. So the idea occurred to Bader and Zwicky at Caltech. This is Walter Bader, who studied mathematics with Hilbert and then became an observational astronomer. Fritz Zwicky, they wrote a very remarkable paper in 1934. The title of that paper was Supernovae and Cosmic Rays. It was just one page long. And I don't think a paper has been written in astronomy with greater density of original ideas than this paper. For one thing, this paper introduced for the very first time the notion of supernovae. Now, this paper can be summarized by three sentences, and here they are. If supernovae initially are quite ordinary stars of mass like the mass of the sun, then the total energy release is of the same order as mc squared. So the energy, because you've taken this guest star and put it in 3 million light years, Zwicky estimated that the energy released in this explosion, or whatever it was, must be comparable to mc squared itself. Extraordinary, right? Therefore, they concluded that in such a supernova process, mass in bulk is annihilated. One didn't know what is the origin of the stellar energy at that time. But their point was, whatever it may be, this cannot be that, radiating 10 to the 33 ergs per second. You suddenly have to release 10 to the power 52 ergs. Therefore, they concluded that mass in bulk must be annihilated. And they also hypothesized that this must be the origin of cosmic rays. So this paper immediately gave a theory for the origin of cosmic rays. Finally, perhaps the most prescient sentence in all of astronomical literature, with all reserve, we advance the view that supernovae represent the transition from ordinary stars into neutron stars, which in their final stages consists of extremely closely packed neutrons. So the basic idea was that a gaseous star of a size of 10 million kilometers in radius, for some reason, collapses to a radius of 10 kilometers. And its density would then be the density of atomic nucleus, which is 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. And they argued that all the protons here would have converted themselves into electrons. Why? They didn't have a clue about why. It's just that the neutron had just been discovered, and they knew it was neutral. And they knew that one positive and one negative charge produces a neutral particle. That is all. But the idea was, if such a thing were to happen, collapse from millions of kilometers or even thousands of kilometers to 10 kilometers, then the gravitational binding energy release is gm squared divided by the initial size minus gm squared divided by the final radius. And therefore, it only depends on the final radius, gm squared by 10 kilometers, which is 10 to the power 53 ergs. So if a star could collapse to 10 kilometer size of Bangalore, then you will have the kind of energy you observe in this guest star of 1885. Why all these things should happen, they had no idea whatsoever. But let's see what happened. First of all, Chadwick discovered the neutron in 1932, just a few months before Baader and Zwicky's paper was. Paper appeared in January 34, but they had written it in 1933, literally within 6 months after the discovery of the neutron. In 1934, Enrico Fermi discovered the theory of beta decay, namely the neutron decays to a proton plus electron plus neutrino, and his student, Giancarlo Wick, discovered the inverse beta decay theory, namely proton combining with electron to produce neutron and a neutrino. Of course, today we know we have to distinguish between neutrino and antineutrino, so we know that this ought to be an antineutrino, and in the inverse beta decay, it will be a neutrino. But those are all irrelevant for our story. And then came the very deep insight due to Landau in 1937-38. Now, what led Landau to this remarkable idea was equally remarkable idea due to Hund in 1936, the idea of neutron matter. The idea that protons and electrons will somehow combine to become neutrons and all of this matter will now become essentially neutron. But there was a difficulty with this. This reaction, proton plus electron going to neutron plus neutrino, is strongly endothermic. In other words, you have to supply energy for this to happen because the rest mass of the proton is less than the rest mass of the neutron. So the amount of energy you need to convert just 1 gram of ordinary matter to neutron matter is truly astronomical, 10 to the power 18 ergs. So what Landau did was to say, but don't worry about this reaction being endothermic. If you're dealing with a very large mass, and if that very large mass can be persuaded to collapse to a smaller radius, then the gravitational binding energy release can drive this endothermic reaction to an exothermic reaction. So this was the idea of Landau. So the idea is electronic matter, as he called it, essentially consisting of protons and electrons, will become almost exclusively neutrons, and its density will be 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. So the idea is a neutronization of matter at high densities. Now, actually, Landau invented this idea to produce stellar energy, why stars shine. But that idea didn't turn out to be the correct idea. Within a year after this, Hans Bethe, of course, worked out the complete theory of proton-proton chain reaction to produce helium and the energy generation in the sun. But this was a rather important watershed. Now, why would such a star collapse? Why would a star which is 1 million kilometers in radius suddenly collapse to 10 kilometers in radius? Here is the modern picture. A gaseous star develops a white dwarf in the central region. Over a course of time, the white dwarf's mass will increase. And as it increases, Allah Chandrasekhar, the central density will increase as proportional to square of the mass. At some stage, the density will increase to 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter, and neutronization of matter will spontaneously begin. As neutrons appear, electrons disappear. As electrons disappear, the pressure of the electrons will decrease because the pressure of the electron is proportional to density to the power 5/3. And therefore, this will be a positive feedback with electrons disappearing and the pressure of the electrons disappearing, and it leads to a dynamical collapse. And this dynamical collapse will happen in a time of the order of 1 millisecond, okay? So the picture then is the white dwarf at the center of a gaseous star collapses to a neutron star, and the energy release, the gravitational binding energy release, drives the supernova explosion, as Bader and Zwicky had conjectured much earlier, but without any theoretical basis. The next chapter of this story is due to Oppenheimer, Robert Oppenheimer, in Berkeley and Caltech. Now, Oppenheimer was very impressed with Landau's paper in Nature on neutron stars. And Landau's paper was actually about the minimum mass of neutron stars. And Oppenheimer quickly pointed out that this is wrong, and therefore he stopped worrying about it. But he asked, should there be a maximum mass for white neutron stars also, just as there was a maximum mass for white dwarfs? So he found a brilliant student whose name was Volkov. And what they did was to calculate the properties of this neutron star exactly like Chandrasekhar had calculated the properties of white dwarfs, except that instead of electrons, this time what supports gravity is the pressure of neutrons. Electrons are not there anymore, so your pressure of neutrons. But Oppenheimer also knew that if a star is size is 10 kilometers, then gravity must be very much stronger than in a white dwarf whose radius was 10,000 kilometers, and therefore you can't use Newtonian gravity. Therefore, Oppenheimer realized that you must use general relativity to calculate the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. But if you had used Newtonian gravity, then there was no need to do that, because Chandrasekhar's theory itself will tell you that when the mean chemical potential is 1, that the limiting mass is 5.76 solar mass. It is this 5.76 divided by 4 which gave you 1.4. So if there are just neutrons, that the mean molecular weight mu is just 1 instead of 2. So the limiting mass for neutron stars in Newtonian gravity is 5.76 solar mass, 4 times the Chandrasekhar limiting mass for white dwarf. But then that result is incorrect, because you ought to use general relativity. What is the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium? Tolmer, Oppenheimer, and Volkov modified the Newtonian equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, which are the terms in yellow, by adding the terms in green, whose origin can be traced to the general theory of relativity. Now, one of the problems I left for you to do this afternoon is to derive this equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. Argue from very simple terms why you have to put in this term and this term and this term. Now, for our purpose, all we need to do is to convince ourselves that this expression is correct, because in the limit C tending to infinity, all these green terms vanish and we recover the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium in Newtonian mechanics. So to construct models of neutron star, like Chandrasekhar had constructed models of white dwarf, you have to integrate this equation, the differential equation. What did they assume for the pressure of the neutron gas? They assumed the same expression Chandrasekhar used, namely the pressure of the neutron gas is proportional to density to the power 5/3. So all that young Volkov had to do was to integrate this equation, and he did that. And this is what he found. What is plotted here is mass in the y-axis versus central density. Previously, I had plotted radius as a function of mass. Alternatively, you can plot mass as a function of central density. So here are the sequence of stable white dwarfs with a maximum mass of 1.4 solar mass. This ought to be 1.4. These are hand-drawn by me, struggling with PowerPoint. So you must drag the curve to 1.4 solar mass. So here are the model sequence of neutron stars constructed by Oppenheimer and his student Volkov. What they found was that there was a maximum over there. Beyond this maximum, as you reduce the mass, the central density increases which doesn't make sense at all. As you reduce the mass, central density must decrease. So they argued that this maximum must represent some, we'll discuss this in the second lecture tomorrow a little more. They argued that this maximum represents a turning point or a point of instability. And they identified this maxima with the maximum mass of a stable neutron star. And that maximum mass turned out to be 0.7 solar mass. So here are the results of the Oppenheimer-Volkoff paper. The maximum mass of neutron stars is 0.7 solar mass. The radius of the neutron star of this mass would be about 10 kilometers, not zero, okay? A white dwarf of maximum mass had zero radius. This time, a neutron star of maximum mass has a radius of 10 kilometers. Its central density is 5 times 10 to the power 15 grams per cubic centimeter. Now, before I comment on this finite radius, Oppenheimer realized already in 1938 that at such high densities, neutrons must repel one another. In 1938, the nature of the nuclear force at such densities was not known. Please remember, the nuclear potential is deduced from scattering experiments. In 1938, one had not done scattering experiments with sufficient energies and therefore at sufficient densities to deduce the structure of the potential at these interparticle spacing. But Oppenheimer conjectured that it must be repulsive, and therefore he argued that this repulsion must also contribute to supporting against gravity along with degeneracy pressure. Therefore, Oppenheimer knew that this 0.7 solar mass is a little on the low side, and he conjectured that the true maximum mass of a neutron star must be a few solar masses. It turned out to be that this is a very brilliant conjecture. So the conclusion of Oppenheimer-Volkoff's paper, of course, was 0.7 solar mass. Now let us answer this question. The Oppenheimer-Volkoff maximum mass is much smaller than the Chandrasekhar limiting mass for a neutron star, which is 5.73 solar mass. At 5.37 or 76 solar mass, the radius of the neutron star goes to zero. I showed you that picture. Why? Because at 5.76 solar mass, the neutron star is ultra-relativistic, and therefore its radius must go to zero. However, at a density of just 10 to the 15 grams per cubic centimeter, or 5 times that, the neutrons are only mildly relativistic. They are not ultra-relativistic. That's why, even at the maximum mass, the neutron star has a finite radius, which is 10 kilometers, and the radius is not zero. So I would like you to actually estimate what is the, from the mean density of the neutron star, what the Fermi momentum or the Fermi velocity ought to be, and convince yourself that it is not ultra-relativistic. So this is an important point. You must convince yourself of this. Why is it that the white dwarf of maximum mass has zero radius, a neutron star of zero mass does not have zero radius? So here is the modern picture. We now know that the internucleon potential energy is attractive, and that at shorter distances, it is in fact repulsive. Now, this repulsion is now better modeled, although still not, we still have not probed the nuclear potential energy, as we will see in tomorrow's lecture, to densities as high as 5 times 10 to the power 15 grams per cubic centimeter. But anyway, the modern picture is that the maximum mass of a white dwarf, I mean a neutron star, is around 2 solar masses. Tomorrow when we discuss the equation of state of neutron stars, I will argue that this is the modern value of this. So Oppenheimer was right in conjecturing that the maximum mass should be a few solar masses. Tomorrow we'll discuss that, when we discuss the equation of state. So the modern picture is that Oppenheimer-Volkoff curve should be rescaled, and it should, I dragged it up to about 2 solar masses over there. This, of course, raised yet another question. What happens to really massive stars which can neither find their peace as white dwarfs supported by electrons or as neutron stars supported by neutrons? What is the fate of these massive stars? But before that, let us ask ourselves, why are there only 2 classes of cold stars? In other words, cold stars means when there is no energy generation, you have a quantum star. Why there are only 2 types of quantum stars, white dwarfs and neutron stars? Why not others? This is a very important question to understand. Now, again, we will discuss this on Thursday in a little greater detail, but for the present, this is adequate. For a star to be stable in Newtonian mechanics, the adiabatic index gamma, which is the ratio of specific heat at constant pressure to specific heat at constant volume, should be greater than 4/3. We will come to this again later. In this introduction, let us not digress. If the value of the adiabatic index gamma becomes less than 4/3, the compressibility of matter becomes negative, and therefore the star will be dynamically unstable. Now, since the density of matter in a star varies from the surface to the center, what value of gamma are you going to use? Because gamma will be different at different radii in the star. Then what the theory tells you is, you must find some kind of an average adiabatic index. Averaged over what? Averaged over the pressure inside the star. So the effective gamma in a dynamical stability analysis is the adiabatic index gamma multiplied by the pressure of the star integrated from center to the surface of the star. We will return to this, as I said. So for our purpose, all we have to appreciate is that if I had an equation of state as a function of, which is pressure as a function of density, then I can calculate gamma at all densities. And the result of such a calculation, which was done in the 60s and 70s, is the following. What is plotted here is the adiabatic index gamma, Cp over Cv, as a function of the logarithm of the density. And the horizontal red dashed line is the critical value of gamma, which is 4/3 in Newtonian mechanics. Please remember that for an ideal gas, gamma is 5/3. And for a photon gas, gamma is 4/3. Therefore, as matter becomes more and more relativistic, it is becoming more and more photon-like, if you like, and therefore, a neutron star or a white dwarf, at the limiting mass, which is becoming relativistic, gamma is approaching 4/3. Anyway, the point is, at some density over here, which is the density when neutronization begins, gamma suddenly drops dramatically below 4/3 and rises above the critical value only around few times 10 to the power 12 gauss. This is the average density, which would correspond, as we will see, to a central density is around 10 to the power 14, few times 10 to the power 14. So what is the significance of this curve? The significance of this curve is that as long as you are above 4/3, the star is stable, but if you drop below 4/3, the star is unstable. So you had stable white dwarfs and neutron stars. Please notice that there was no minimum mass for a neutron star in Oppenheimer-Volkoff theory, just as there was no minimum mass for a white dwarf in Chandrasekhar's theory. Now, the intermediate density is between 10 to the power 9 grams per cubic centimeter and 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. There was no equation of state till John Wheeler and his series of students and collaborators in Princeton, starting with Harrison and Wheeler, constructed equation of states at all densities. We'll return to this tomorrow. And so I can now borrow that Harrison-Wheeler equation of state and fill in this over there, and then use this graph to ask which branches are going to be stable and which branches of this are going to be unstable. So here is the result. In this intermediate region, gamma is less than 4 by 3. Why did gamma become less than 4 by 3? Because that is where neutronization was taking place and electrons were disappearing, and therefore matter became soft and compressibility of matter became negative, the dynamical collapse that I talked about earlier. So you have, again, beyond the extremum over there, matter is unstable, but not because gamma is less than 4 by 3, but because of general relativistic instabilities, and we will return to this also later on. And it is this instability that is the main theme for this summer school, namely when you're talking of gravitational radiation, it is that second instability that is important. But I'll come back to that. So this is the answer that I would like to give you. There are only two classes of cold stars because in the in-between region, gamma is less than 4 by 3, and the star is unstable to radial pulsations. And beyond that, of course, as we will again see on Thursday, it becomes irrelevant to answer this question because you're very close already in a neutron star to a black hole radius, and then the next equilibrium is of academic discussion because you're inside the black hole. Now, what is the fate of massive stars? So we should end on that note. Now, the fate of massive stars was discovered by Chandrasekhar already in 1932. Now, this is perhaps his most brilliant discovery from that phase, but unfortunately, it is seldom to be found in books and even more seldom to be found in the literature. And therefore, I would like to take a few minutes to tell you about this truly important discovery. At the discovery made in 1932, please do not confuse this with the limiting mass of white dwarfs. This has nothing whatsoever to do with it. Is that if the radiation pressure of the gas exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure is sum of gas pressure plus radiation pressure. If radiation pressure exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure, then matter will never become degenerate, no matter what the density is. Please recall what saved the companion of Sirius is that when the density became high, Fowler said the rules of quantum mechanics will take over and classical rules will fail. And that is what led to white dwarfs, and that is what led to neutron stars. But now Chandrasekhar is saying, but when I really go to very high densities, matter will not become degenerate. Very paradoxical, right? But this is an exact statement. I will prove it to you now. When do you say that a gas obeys classical physics? You say that when KT, which is the thermal energy, is much larger than the quantum energy, which is the Fermi energy. Or stated differently, the numerical value of the pressure you calculate using Boyle's law should be much greater than the pressure you calculate using Fermi-Dirac statistics. Okay? So this argument about whether the high density matter will remain classical or quantum has to be answered by calculating the pressure according to the two formulae and comparing them. But it's like comparing apples and oranges, because the pressure of an ideal gas depends both on the density and temperature, whereas the pressure of a quantum mechanical gas is independent of temperature. So we have to know how to solve this little problem. And Chandrasekhar did that by using a trick that Eddington had introduced in his book. I'll do this slowly so that you can write it down, okay? Now what I have written here is the total pressure in terms of a fraction beta. So I've written total pressure is 1 over beta times the gas pressure, or 1 over 1 minus beta times radiation pressure. Okay? So beta is a fraction of the total pressure contributed by gas, and 1 minus beta is the fraction contributed by radiation. Why does one introduce this parameter beta? Because I can now equate the second and third terms in the equation on the top, these two, which I have rewritten here, and solve for temperature in terms of the density and this fraction beta. So that equation in that magenta rectangle, it tells me that instead of temperature, I can use this factor times rho to the power 1/3. So I can write Boyle's law now, instead of as a function of rho and T, I can write Boyle's law as a function of rho and beta. We haven't got rid of temperature, but we are expressing it in terms of the fraction. And if I do that, this is the expression that I get. Gas pressure, this is Boyle's law, nkT, or rho kT in terms of, I have to put the mass in the numerator and denominator, nkT becomes rho kT by mu mp, is now written as a function of density alone and this fraction beta. So the gas pressure now is a function of beta, known function of beta, multiplied by rho to the power 4/3. The quantum mechanical pressure is a function of density to some power. So now both are apples, I can compare them. So that is the trick. So if you now I can ask, here is gas pressure, Cf beta times rho to the power 4/3. Here is the degeneracy pressure, rho to the power 4/3. Why I'm not using rho to the power 5/3? I am talking of matter at very high densities. At very high densities, you expect the matter to be relativistic. So if degeneracy does set in, it will set in a relativistic manner. But what about Boyle's law? That was all pre-relativity, 19th century, right? But you'll see, Boyle's law is valid even in relativity. That's one of the exercises for you to do. Okay, now let's go back to the condition. What is the condition that classical pressure is greater than the degeneracy pressure? In other words, what is the condition that the gas will remain ideal and not quantum? The condition is, this must be greater than this. This must be greater than this. That boils down to, since both sides have rho to the power 4/3, density cancels out. So it is this function C of beta should be greater than K2, which is the constant that appears in the degeneracy pressure formula, which I asked you to work out. This can be solved very simply, and the simplification tells me that this inequality is same as 1 minus beta greater than 0.092. What is 1 minus beta? 1 minus beta is the fraction that radiation pressure contributes to the total pressure. Therefore, if radiation pressure is more than 9.2% of the total pressure, the pressure calculated according to Boyle's law is always greater than the pressure calculated according to Fermi-Dirac statistics, and therefore the gas remains ideal. And so here the sentence from Chandrasekhar's paper: if radiation pressure exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure, then matter will never become degenerate, no matter what the density is. Therefore, stars above a critical mass, we were asking, they can't become white dwarf, they can't become neutron star, what will they be? Whatever they may be, they cannot become degenerate, they cannot become quantum stars. Extremely non-intuitive result, isn't it? Density became million grams per cubic. Matter is degenerate to the density of copper and sodium on Earth. Why million grams per cubic centimeter? Right? But now we are saying at very high densities matter. So here is the, by the way, here is the thing. If degeneracy does set in at high densities, the gas will be relativistic. So please convince yourself that, to quote Chandrasekhar, Boyle's law is valid regardless of relativity. Just a passing sentence in his 1932 paper. Convince yourself that the pressure of an ideal gas is regardless of special relativity. Okay? So, one picture is worth 10,000 words, ancient Chinese saying. So I'll repeat this argument pictorially now. What is plotted here is the logarithm of the pressure as a function of logarithm of the density. And this dashed blue line is density to the power 5 by 3, which is non-relativistic degeneracy. Above a certain density, matter becomes ultra-relativistic, and the pressure is density to the power 4 by 3. You got it? Fine. Now, I'm going to compare this with the pressure of an ideal gas. The pressure of an ideal gas expressed as a function of beta and rho to the power 4 by 3, the formula that we had written down before. So you notice that this magenta curve is a slope of 4 by 3, which is the same slope as the relativistic degeneracy formula. Therefore, here radiation pressure is only 2%, gas pressure is 98%. So you see that up to a certain density, ideal gas pressure is greater, therefore gas is classical over here, but above that critical density where that green spot is, the degeneracy pressure is greater, and therefore matter will become degenerate. Now let's increase the radiation pressure fraction. Now I increase the radiation pressure precisely to 908, this curve 2. Radiation pressure is 9.2% of the total pressure. So now you notice that this dashed red line, which is the classical ideal gas pressure, coincides with the relativistic degeneracy pressure beyond the critical density. Now let's increase the radiation pressure a little more than 9.2%. The curves don't cross at all. So you see, this 9.2% of the radiation pressure, this curve here, is the limiting value of the radiation pressure so that the ideal gas, so if the radiation pressure is greater than that, here it's becoming less and less, right? Gas pressure, radiation pressure becomes more and more dominant. So gas remains ideal. You notice the gas remains ideal no matter how high the density becomes, okay? So this is the famous discovery of 1932. And the final sentence of his historic paper: for all stars above a critical mass, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and matter does not become degenerate. an appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. And this paper was written long before Oppenheimer and Volkov's paper. And therefore, if Chandrasekhar had drawn this picture that I have drawn, he would have said, don't put a question mark there. These stars will collapse to singularity. What this value of this critical mass is a different thing that depends on modeling, but the physics is very, very precise. It is at that density where radiation pressure exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure. I don't know whether Oppenheimer was aware of this paper by Chandrasekhar or not, but having discovered the maximum mass of neutron stars with his young student Volkov, Oppenheimer naturally set out to investigate the fate of massive stars. He knew that this would have to be done in the premise of general relativity. So he looked for another brilliant student, but this guy had to be very good in mathematics and very careful with mathematics. And he found such a student. His name was Hartland Snyder. Now, I would like to tell you something interesting about this Hartland Snyder that you may not know. He was a truck driver, driving one of these big American trucks. At some point, he got fed up. He said, look, I want to do something different in life. He was interested in theoretical physics. So he asked some friend, where should I go? He said, look, there is this very smart guy in Berkeley. His name is Robert Oppenheimer. You go and work with him. So he sent him to Berkeley. Now, those of you who have read some books about Oppenheimer would know that he and his students formed a gang which transcended just their interaction in physics. It went into music and food and literature. It was a very different culture, but Snyder was a very different kind of student. But he was extremely careful with mathematics, not just good in mathematics. And that was what was needed for this particular problem. So Oppenheimer, or OP as he used to be called, picked Snyder to study the implosion of a massive star in general relativity. Now this is obviously a very difficult problem. In 1937, there were no computers at that time. So he told Snyder, look, I allow you to make some approximations. You assume the star to be spherically symmetric, so it's not rotating. You also assume that there are no pressure forces inside the star, there is no energy generation, there are no shock waves and things like that. So it is an ideal, what astronomers would, cosmologists would call as a star made of dust. There's no pressure. But then he said, having made this assumption about the star, you cannot make any mathematical assumptions. You have to solve this problem exactly within premise of general theory of relativity. Now, remarkably, Snyder succeeded in doing this, and the result he found was rather stunning. The result can be summarized in two sentences. He found that as the star nears a certain critical radius, as seen by an observer far away, its shrinkage slows down and down and down till finally the star becomes frozen at a certain critical radius. However, a physicist falling with the star finds a completely different situation. As seen by an observer riding on the surface of the star, the implosion does not freeze at all. It accelerates, as common sense would tell you, and the star disappears. In the final sentence of their paper is, when all thermonuclear sources of energy are exhausted, a sufficiently massive star will collapse. The radius of the star approaches asymptotically its gravitational radius. The light from the surface of the star is progressively reddened and can escape over a progressively narrower range of angles. The star thus tends to close itself off from any communication with a distant observer. Only its gravitational field persists. And this paper appeared in Physical Review on the day the Second World War broke out. And so naturally did not get the kind of immediate attention it would have otherwise got. But there were other reasons too. Now this, therefore, this picture can be updated now after Oppenheimer and Snyder's paper, that sufficiently massive stars will become black holes and, as we will see, collapse to singularities, exactly as Chandrasekhar had said in 32. But these two conclusions, Chandrasekhar 1932-34 and Oppenheimer and Snyder 1939, were truly revolutionary. And they challenged what this gentleman had said a long time ago and which prevailed for 2,000 years. According to the Aristotelian doctrine, the matter of which the heavens are made is imperishable and thus not subject to generation or corruption. The heavens are perfect. Nothing can happen. In contrast, he also said, the earth is made up of classical elements and is perishable. The motions in heavens are eternal and perfect. Greeks had this obsession with circles. That's why they invented epicycles. They didn't like ellipses. The heavens are the realm of peace and perfection. So this was the view that prevailed for 2,000 years. And that view was challenged by Chandrasekhar and Oppenheimer. But different people, well, let's recall finally what Chandrasekhar actually said. In 1932, for all stars of mass greater than M, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and the matter does not become degenerate. An appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. Great progress in the analysis of stellar structure is not possible before it can answer the following fundamental question. Given an enclosure containing electrons and atomic nuclei, what happens if we go on compressing the material indefinitely? So we had answers to that question between 1932, the discovery of neutrons, and neutronization of matter. And finally, it is necessary to emphasize one major result of the whole investigation, namely that it must be taken as well established that the life history of a star of a small mass must be essentially different from the life history of a star of large mass. For a star of small mass, the natural white dwarf stage is an initial step towards complete extinction. The star of large mass cannot pass into the white dwarf stage, and one is left speculating on other possibilities. We have stated what those possibilities are. What was the reaction? The reaction of Eddington was, I do not know whether I shall escape from this meeting alive, but the point of my paper is there is no such thing as relativistic degeneracy. Chandrasekhar, using the relativistic formula, which has been accepted for the last 5 years, shows that a star of mass greater than a certain limit remains a perfect gas and can never cool down. The star has to go on radiating and radiating and contracting until, suppose, it gets down to a few kilometer radius when gravity becomes strong enough to hold in the radiation and the star can at last find peace. Dr. Chandrasekhar had got this result before, but he has rubbed it in his last paper. And when I was discussing with him, I felt driven to the conclusion that this was almost reductio ad absurdum of the relativistic degeneracy formula. Various accidents may intervene to save the star, but I want more protection than that. I think there should be a law of nature to prevent a star from behaving in this absurd way. In 1939, Einstein wrote a paper, and the conclusion of that paper was, an essential result of this investigation is a clear understanding as to why the Schwarzschild singularities do not exist in physical realities. So with such emphatic rejection of the ideas of Chandrasekhar and Oppenheimer, the Aristotelian view prevailed. It prevailed for 50 years until one day in August 1968, when young Jocelyn Bell made a stunning discovery that heralded the new revolution and the overthrow of the Aristotelian view. So that is an overall summary of stellar remnants and how we got to where we understand things today. So tomorrow and Wednesday, I will continue with our discussion of neutron stars. Tomorrow, we will discuss the interior of neutron stars, the equation of states, and revisit the maximum mass, and things like superfluidity, superconductivity inside neutron stars. And day after tomorrow, after all, this school is about gravitational waves. Gravitational waves from neutron stars are more relevant in one context for isolated neutron stars when they are spinning really fast. So in the third lecture, I will discuss how to spin up a neutron star to millisecond periods. So to set the stage for next week's lecture by Professor Nils Andersson. I'll be happy to answer questions if you have any. Thank you very much.
I was wondering about the radiation pressure. So Chansika said...
There's a switch there.
Hello. So radiation, Chansika said the radiation pressure has to be greater than 9.2% to avoid the degeneracy. But how can we make sure that this is the condition throughout the evolution of the star? It could be the condition initially or at some stage, but then due to high radiation pressure, it can lose a lot of mass in the wind, and then it can go to degeneracy. How can we make sure that the radiation pressure gets...
It's a very interesting and a very deep question. And that took a lot of several decades to have the answer to this question. Because that... You're absolutely right. To calculate the radiation pressure, you must have a physics of cooling. Now, for low densities, the cooling is mainly due to photons. But as the star evolves, as you rightly said, beyond carbon stage, the nuclear reactions produce more and more neutrinos. So the cooling is essentially due to neutrinos. Okay? And that's what finally, that's why you massive stars develop degenerate iron cores. That's why the reaction goes till then. You see, if the stars had developed degenerate cores before, they would blow themselves up as type 1 supernovae, as people had conjectured before. The reason why that does not happen is neutrinos keep the radiation pressure low till you finally reach iron 56, or really massive stars. So I recommend you to read Chandrasekhar's Nobel lecture in Reviews of Modern Physics. So where he discusses this. So it took a long time. You're absolutely right. But then there is a mass. That is the point. Where but the crux of your question is, you must have the physics of cooling well under control before you can estimate the radiation pressure. But this thing holds. Arnott's calculation showed, and Chandrasekhar refers to it in his Nobel lecture, that finally, when silicon burns to produce carbon, the neutronal luminosity is so high, matter radiation pressure is brought down. And that's why the iron becomes a white dwarf. And then within a matter of 8 or 10 hours, it goes to the limiting mass and collapses to form a neutron star. So all is well with this theorem.
Thank you.